Yes, yes. Welcome to the ancient world of tabletop games. I am Agamemnon from the historical documentary Time Bandits. This is a report from a fugitive.
Here's another dice tower. This one's a steampunk furnace version by E-Raptor. It is self-assembly, and you'll need the skills of a surgeon just to remove the components from the trappings. How do we go from that to this? With great care. I didn't use great care. Instead, I relied on 10 thumbs. 10 thumbs grant you 2 attacks every 2 rounds in almost all role-playing games that permit combat. And that is a role-playing fact. A skeletal rat and dice not included. Spangly dice also not included. There's an important item that's not meant to be included, as the box informs us glue is not required. The exact type of glue that's definitely not needed is PVA wood glue, and I recommend having some nearby just in case. Yes, being all thumbs, I resorted to the use of wood glue, and that saved me the major bother of being all thumbs and breaking everything. This isn't a regular construction video, it's an irregular construction video. In this educational movie, I'll show you pieces that don't go quite where they should, and that's for purposes of illustration. It's also for reasons of putting those pieces in the wrong locations, but that's neither here nor there. First it's here, and then it's there. As I make this video, there are no instructions included with the E-Raptor Steampunk Furnace Dice Tower. I was hard-pressed to find a how-to video online, certainly not from the company, and the closest I reached was a speeded-up segment of a film by GMS Magazine. A rather frustrated Paco, who is normally the unflappable host of many an unboxing video, the go-to guy on game components and accessories, really struggled with this one, and I too, following in Paco's feverish footsteps, really struggled with this one. To commemorate my battle with the components, I name this dice tower Moloch, after the machine that runs rampant in Fritz Lang's Metropolis. Instead of sacrificing workers to its maw, I choose to sacrifice dice. Health and safety be damned. On with the show. From flat pack nightmare to dice-rattling monstrosity in 500 not-so-easy steps. The purpose of this film is to shame E-Raptor into making their own construction video. I'll start with the 4 sheets in the package. Not that I received 4 sheets. They must have been to the wind. I opened the pack to find 2 sheets and a few loose bits and pieces. Luckily, I decoded this puzzle and carried on as if nothing untoward had happened. Here are the fiddly items spread across 2 sheets with a small bag of metal bits that you must not lose or misplace in any way, shape, or fashion. I soon found them again before they were needed. Sheets 1 and 2 out of 4 proved to be the only sheets, but hey, at least they were labelled. The loose bits were for the front, back, the tower floor, and the very front of the dice cage. I see 4 sheets stacked in the product photo on the website. At least I didn't have to remove those pieces from the frames. Taking the components away from their frames is an evil process designed to test the patience of 3 saints, none of them patient. Luckily, I avoided pinging the smaller pieces across the room into the gloom, and I didn't break anything at that stage. I considered that a bonus. Let's get this out of the way. The product smells of its creation process. If your kink is covertly sniffing wood products that carry a hint of the bonfire to their scents, then you are more than covered here. We do not judge. Don't sniff wood glue. That'll end badly. I thought about the order of events in constructing this monument to automated dice rolling and decided to fly off the handle. This may not be the best place to start, though it illustrates a point about dealing with the joining mechanisms used in a no-glue product. The handle is made up of 3 parts, and the handle sides fit on the main section without difficulty. Apply pressure to get past the fixing part of the prongs. Do not use all 10 thumbs for this. Wear a safety helmet and a seat belt. If you break it, you pay for it. Throughout this video, I assemble and disassemble sections just to let you see the process with a level of clarity that did its best to elude me as I wrestled with small, fragile pieces. There are better ways to go about this, but this was all I had. As usual, keep pets and small children treated as pets out of the room. Use strong lighting and stronger coffee. Here's the dice cage, made up of the floor, two gates, and a front end that stops the dice from rolling off the tower floor onto your table. Close examination of the gates and the front end will show those pieces are engraved on the outer side. You needn't assemble the pieces that way, as I'll discuss later. The main tower holds the baffle box and the trap doors that the dice fall through. Those trap doors are worked by cogwheels that fit into the face on the front of the tower. Construction order is your business. I started with the baffle box. Baffle boxes prove popular and unpopular in backgammon. Away from that game, we recognize the baffle box as a dice tower. This baffle box has three baffles. Top and middle boards are the same size, and the larger baffle is the ramp at the bottom, leading to the tower floor. I'll put all three baffles in to show you what's what. The middle baffle is the fiddly one. When you add that one to the sideboard, you'll see that it doesn't slide in smoothly the way the top and bottom baffles do. For that reason, I recommend adding it first and fitting it to both sideboards before you place the other baffles. With all three baffles in place across the two boards, you almost have a complete baffle box. You'll need to fit this into the front and rear pieces of the tower, but don't fit them all the way in. Leave that for now. In this part of the construction, I add the front and rear tower sections to the floor, and I click those carefully into place. You're looking to add the rear to the floor, then place the baffle box in there, followed by the front securing everything. However, this is for purposes of illustration only. You can't fit that into one solid construction at this stage. You still need wiggle room to add the trapdoors later. And my plan was to leave the trapdoors until much later. So bear in mind, I'm just showing you where the main framework comes together. Don't lose sight of the face you'll build later, with all the delight of cogwheels and trapdoors and metal fixings to throw to the dogs in the wrong order. Big fun. Speaking of cogs, there are three types. Slotted cogs, including the cogs that feature as part of the handle. The same slots again, with large braking spurs on them. And the pinned cogs, held in place by metal fixings. The pinned cogs have blank sides. Maybe you prefer those. That's your choice. I placed the brake cogs in the wrong location, thinking they were part of the upper mechanism, but they fit out of sight and out of mind on the underside, which we'll get to shortly. Also of note are the slotted discs. I placed those in the wrong locations too. You want the wood-stained sides facing out when attaching them to the trap doors. Those fixings, shaped like tiny X-wings, are the fiddliest of fiddliest components. Luckily, even if they snap, there are a few spares. Let's turn to the underside. The main construction is in place, including the baffle box. I'll loosen that to add the trapdoors nearer the end of the process. For now, we are dealing with the unseen cog mechanism that holds the barred gates in place. One of the most important pieces is this cross piece. I'm going to reverse the crosspiece for easier contrast, with the wood stain hidden. This crosspiece fits across four obvious holes, too large and too small. That's just for positioning in this video. For actual assembly, cogwheels fit under the crosspiece against the dice tower floor. If we look at it from the other side, you'll see where the metal pins go in. There's countersinking there in the floor, but it doesn't amount to much. Go in closer and you'll see the wood-stained crosspiece, which you won't see with a cogwheel in place. Does it matter which way up that crosspiece is? No one's going to see it. I leave that to you. I matched the wood-stain to the underside of the floor, assembled for final use. Now we deal with the flimsiest part of the construction, those gates and the slots at the bottom. These slots are quite fragile. In the end, I break them. There's just a little too much force involved and they get bent out of shape. Not the problem. The problem was trying to bend them back, and the only possible result was snapping them. I couldn't leave them at an angle and hope to pin them in place as working models, so I did the obvious thing, and I snapped them off. Before we even get into that, though, add a disc to the gatepost. You'll find some of the wood scraped away in these shots, and that's as a result of a few squeaky moments in adding discs to the gates. Wood-stained portion of the disc is uppermost, as it is on open display in the finished machine. Just a word about those gates. The circle on the gate's decorative lock is part of the right-hand gate. You can tell by the engraved line around the disc. The pattern is the same on the other side of the gate, without the engraving. You might want the lock to appear on the left-hand gate, and there's nothing wrong in that if it's your preference. I went for consistency and having engraved portions on outer-facing surfaces. There's the gate with a fragile portion underneath. I've removed the cross piece for clarity. More discs fit into the gates, as we'll see. Forgetting those discs leads to loose rattling gates, and fixing things led me to worn surfaces as I moved gates back and forth. Luckily, those worn surfaces are out of sight, having been snapped off. Every cloud. I'll say a few words about metal fixings. There's an obvious design choice here, but you needn't follow the path. I've shown the fixings in place, upside down, minus the end caps, just to give an idea of what juts out of the assembly. The gates have areas carved out of them to accommodate the metal pins, but only if the pins are inserted the right way up. Why would you choose to add the pins upside down? Here I've assembled the finished article on the left and a reversed pin on the right. Countersinking does little for the pin on the left, it's not exactly flush. I used a 2mm hex key to ensure tightness, but you don't need micro-sized tools to get the job done. If you want the pin to stick out as shown on the right, bear in mind that the gates won't close over the additional metal. Dice rattle down the baffles and pass over the nearly flush pins with ease. If you're looking for more of a pinball deflection or the chance to stop a die dead in its tracks, then you could fit the pins upside down. In the final construction, I left the pins as intended, so that the gates would close over them with ease. The unseen cogwheels allow the gates to open and close together, if you're looking for a bit of ceremony in preparing the furnace to accept dice. Time to take a look at the cogwheel assembly, and where things went wrong for me. This is the assembly in place, with the crosspiece the other way around for a bit of contrast. It little matters which way around the cogwheels and crosspiece are, as no one is going to see them from there. The cogs on the extreme left and right are the wrong ones. Use the ones with braking spurs. The brakes or limiters aren't much use for reasons of construction I'll get into. Also on this image, the pins are shown flush here, meaning it's a game of pinball on the other side if you install the end caps on the dice tower factory floor side. I was curious about the wiggle room with the doors and ultimately decided against that version. Maybe you'll like it. Aside from everything that's wrong with this picture, we're doing not so bad. The X-Wing fighter pin on the left is too far inside the slot for the gate. That one on the right is just far enough into the construction to hold all the gate items in place. We'll switch to talk about the dice cage. The cage forms with the furnace gates open and the front piece in position. There it is. Balance it carefully on top of the prongs and press it gently into place. Before you do, check for the engraved lines as part of the pattern. That front piece has the same design on both sides, but the engraving only on the front. This is the same kind of engraved detail that appears on the gates and also on the top of the trapdoor pieces. Now let's assemble the underside the right way around with the proper cogwheels eventually in place. Misplacing the cogs was my downfall, yet my downfall out of sight and out of mind on the underside of the dice tower was my saving grace higher up when assembling the trapdoor sections. I discovered early how fragile the posts were. The gate needs a disc on it, with wood stain uppermost and visible when assembled. Then an unstained disc has to go on there as well. Fit the gate post down through the large circular hole in the dice tower floor. You can see where some of the material on the gatepost frayed away, with the discs being fitted. Then the cog goes on the bottom. This is still the wrong cog, but you get the idea. The fiddly part is assembling metal pins for the cogs and deciding which way around you want them. I'll be taking those metal end caps off to fit the right cogs on in a wee while. With the crosspiece in position, another disc goes in and leaves the assembly solid. No rattling around. On top of that, it's time for another disc. For reasons of the plot, I just grabbed any old disc, but I should have had a wood-stained piece on there. With all the discs in place, it's time for the X-Wing peg to go in. Very gently. These pegs are prone to snap if pressed too far. Once we pull back to take a look at the overall assembly, you'll see I've put the right cogs on, and I've added the wood-stained discs. Cog changeover is what messed me up. I'd adjusted the gateposts too many times and they weakened as I went to pin the X-Wing pegs in. The best option was to snap what would break off anyway, so I took both ends of the damaged posts out of there and applied a dab of wood glue to the discs, fixing them to the broken posts. If this happens to you, make sure it is just a dab of wood glue, avoiding the freely moving sections and you'll be fine. It was a tricky break, but not a tricky repair. And this mini-disaster saved me later as I realised how fragile the pins and the posts were. I faced the same difficulty with the trapdoors, but at least these broken pieces weren't readily visible. Fortunately, the posts snapped with enough material sticking out as prongs to make the glue repair job simple, and I learned to be careful with the trapdoors. Looking at the gatepost on its side, we see from left to right the bottom disc, the crosspiece. There's a disc unseen inside the crosspiece, then the cogwheel, followed by the main floor frame with an unseen disc inside the large circular hole, and then the wood-stained disc held in place by the gate itself. A lot of layers. Get those in the right order first time, and you'll reduce the risk of weakening the bottom of the gatepost. Ordinarily, an X-Wing peg would be there at the very bottom, holding everything in. Even with their ends glued in, the gates have plenty of jiggle in them to allow operation. Going back to the underside, the braking mechanism, the limiter effect of the extended spur. spur on the cogwheel is a redundant feature. I think this part was over-engineered out of caution. The gates worked well enough with the wrong cogwheels in place, after all. And here's why. The spurs are meant to prevent the gates from slipping inside the furnace, yet the baffle box assembly stops the gates from heading in there anyway. That last bar in the gate on the right sits over the internal wall of the baffle box, keeping the gate from sliding in, no matter how far round the cogwheel could move, even with the wrong type of cogwheel whirring. By this point, there's little left to assemble. It's tricky, of course. We're going to add the trapdoors and the handle and the cogwheels to the main assembly. In short, we're putting a face on it all and seeing if it blinks. Just a reminder that the design appears on both sides of the trapdoor pieces, but only one side has that engraved section, and you'll want that facing up the way. Again, we're using the metal pins. I placed the end caps on the outside to give more of an outstanding eye effect on the face. I don't believe there's enough clearance for the trapdoor if the end caps are placed inside the baffle box, even though there are cutaway sections on the doors to avoid the flush side of the metal pin construction. Let's return to an earlier shot in the assembly process. Here the baffle box is snug inside the main tower. Loosen the prongs and get those trapdoors through the circular holes. That's where they are going. But line all your ducks up in a row. You're placing trapdoors, wooden discs, and the dice tower cogwheel handle in there. Get this right first time. Outward facing discs are wood stained. Other discs fit inside the unseen areas to provide bracing. Remember all those layers inside the gatepost. Same business again here. So loosen up the baffle box wall. Get your discs in place on the trapdoor. Obviously I used the wrong discs in this example, but the end result worked out. Add the handle with its inbuilt cogs on the right of the tower. All the cogs at the tower corners are slotted, and you'll pin them with the X-wing fixtures, not too tightly. These slotted areas are fragile and you don't want to ruin the trapdoors. You'll find a bit of give in the trap sections. That needs to be there. Don't worry about it. If the cogs all go in too tightly, then it'll be so much harder to operate the trap mechanism. It's okay if the trapdoors don't align perfectly. That's your wiggle room right there. You don't want to build the whole monstrosity and discover that the doors are fixed in place too tightly to drop dice, or that you've offset the trapdoors, leaving a large gap when supposed to be shut. Time to check out that face. You'll pin a pair of spectacles, this grey crosspiece, over a pair of eyes, cogwheels, and that mechanism attached to the handle works the trapdoors. You may well find a better order of construction when throwing these pieces together. To fix the pins in position, the trapdoors must be in place and open down inside the baffle box. Make sure the flush ends are inside the box and the protruding end caps are coming out of the eyes on the front of the face. Work the mechanism gently. At worst, you'll have to undo the arrangement and align the cogwheels to give a smoother operation. That's not true. At worst, you could lose patience and punt the whole box through a window. That's that. You have a platform for loading dice onto, and a handle for dropping those dice into the belly of the beast. From there, the dice rattle out into that protective cage with the gates to either side and the bumper at the end holding the results in place. Was this the trickiest dice tower I've assembled? It's the first assembly I've broken. Breaking bits didn't matter. Wood glue fixed all minor crimes. I look at the E-Raptor castle I built in no time, adding a touch of red felt to roll out the carpet. The mechanical tower from Black Thumb Creations was a bear, a growly bear, to assemble without splintering it to matchwood, and that included digging into it to fix a minor glitch. The submarine hatch version from Basically Wooden came fully assembled, and I'm starting to think that's my favourite kind of dice tower. Built. Yet here reigns Moloch, of baleful eye and fiery tongue, sacrificing unsuspecting dice to the gaming gods for their sport and entertainment. Tremble at the sight, or at the least, shiver over the prospect of assembling the demonic machine.